Hey everybody, this is Mrs. Malloy, and this is lecture number two, the Italian Renaissance and the Northern Renaissance. Okay, so from what we've learned about the various stages of the Middle Ages, as well as from our last lecture, it seems clear that Europe was undergoing much change between 1000 AD and 1500 AD. And I think this is really what John Green was talking about in his crash course video on the Renaissance, remember? You know, the one in which he argued that the term Renaissance is a construct that people from the present have created about the hundreds of years that it supposedly encompassed. You know, it's easy to say that a lot happened within a 500-year period, but you know, of course a lot happened. A lot has happened here in the USA from 1776 to the present day, and that's roughly 237 years ago. So, duh, of course a lot has happened. You know, so what about this whole Renaissance construct? Do you need to remember for your Regents exam and for class? We'll get to that. You know, just as John Green argued that there wasn't such a thing as the Renaissance, it's more a term that we refer to that, you know, those hundreds of years as the Renaissance, you know, saying that it's a construct. There are also other groups of people who really disagree with what John Green says in his Crash Course videos. So keep in mind that, you know, there's no one person who has, you know, this all-knowing knowledge of history, and people disagree. That's what history is all about. In fact, one group recently created an art history rebuttal to John Green's video. It's a group, student group known as Amor Siendi, and please excuse my Italian pronunciation. Anyway, this was a student group that created, or they do create, art history videos, and they do a lot on the Renaissance. Recently, they just created a rebuttal video in response to John Green's claim, so I think you should check it out. Again, it's Amor Siendi, and it's they call it The Renaissance Was a Thing. That's their video on YouTube. So check it out, because they disagree with John Green, and you can find out how and why they disagree with what he said in his Crash Course video. Alright, well, I'm going to use the Renaissance as a specific time in history, so listen. The Renaissance is a term, yes, we use to describe the end of the Middle Ages through about 1600 in Europe. The term itself means rebirth in French. And here's what you really need to understand, in my opinion. Historians today look back on those 300 to 400 years, and then they really say that there was a revival in art and learning. We're going to see an increased emphasis on Greco-Roman culture, which is going to present itself in art, literature, architecture, as well as political thought. And eventually, what we now call the Renaissance is going to spread to Northern Europe and eventually lead to people questioning the church's power and authority over everyday life. And this is going to lead to a complete revolution within the church called something called the Reformation, which we'll get to later, and the subsequent counter or Catholic Reformation period. So why do people believe that the Renaissance happened? And why did it emerge or start in a place like Italy? First of all, overseas trade and cultural diffusion, which was inspired by the contact that Europeans had with the Middle East during the Crusades, will make many people rich in Europe, particularly merchants from the Italian city-states. We're going to start to see the emergence of large cities throughout these Italian city-states in the 1300s. Italy's location in the middle of important trade routes on the Mediterranean, with cities like Florence and Venice, naturally made it a location where cultural diffusion and new ideas flourished. A merchant class of people are going to emerge, including famous families like the Medici family in Florence, who were primarily bankers. As such families became richer and richer, they naturally felt that they had a right to rule other people in a government capacity. And we will start to see this idea that money equals political power. So to summarize what I've said so far, a merchant class of people will emerge around the time of what we now call the Renaissance. These merchants are going to grow rich from trade in cities like Florence, and they're going to include famous families like the Medici. This merchant class of people will eventually demand political rule because of their social power and wealth. So the bottom line, the Italian city-states were perfectly located for trade and cultural diffusion. And with near constant contact with the advanced Islamic empires at the time, new ideas are going to spread to Europe. All right, once again, Renaissance means rebirth. in French. And you know, we refer to the period in Europe from around the mid-1300s to the 1500s as a period of rebirth or renewed learning. And although this learning and new artwork only affected perhaps a small percentage of the overall population at the time, maybe the rich people, traders, artists, and clergy members, you know, it really was an age influenced by advanced Islamic civilizations, most notably the Ottoman Empire. You know, you should remember the Ottoman Turks who controlled Anatolia, or modern-day Turkey, after the defeat of the crumbling Byzantine Empire by the 1300s. All right, well, during the Renaissance period, we're going to see the creation of what became known as powerful Italian city-states. They were sort of like mini-countries, each of which was ruled by a powerful family who traded a lot and then got rich, like the Medici family in Florence. These families will begin to influence politics in their respective city-states, and we're going to start to see the beginning of the idea that money equals power. This is also significant because it marked the beginning of what we call social mobility for many people. I mean, even today in our nation, social class and power in society, it's often determined by how much wealth a person has, and not just by your family's background or an official title. One can argue that this new social mobility marked an end to feudalism, you know, where titles were bestowed on people by nobles and kings, generation after generation. With this new social mobility in the Italian city-states, we will also begin to see rich people celebrating their worldly successes through art and literature. You know, basically, people wanted to show off all that wealth, and so they commissioned artists, which means they hired them, to paint elaborate artwork to adorn the walls of their personal cathedrals or homes. You know, think MTV Cribs, yo. Is that show still on even? Anyway, so rich families became patrons, also called financial supporters, of the arts. All right, well, what this shows is that we're going to start to see a focus during the Renaissance on secular or worldly pleasures during that time period. We're going to start to see people valuing the idea that all people should strive to do well in all aspects of life. And we will see rich merchant families encouraging their offspring, that's their children, people, to pursue multiple areas of study. The ideal man, because women still didn't enjoy equality, sorry, ladies, you know, the ideal man was someone who studied art, music, politics, they were athletic, they studied medicine, foreign languages. Wow, sounds like the typical Brighton kids after school agenda. But seriously, people, the idea that kids can and should pursue a wide variety of activities and subjects and excel at all of them, you know, it's a notion that can arguably be attributed to the Renaissance idea of a universal man or a Renaissance man. In fact, you can blame Castiglione for your fully engaged after-school schedules, people. It's not your parents, so don't blame them. Yeah, a famous writer from the Renaissance named Baldassare Castiglione, please don't judge my lame Italian accent or lack thereof, and look him up on your vocabulary list in your packet if spelling is important to you, which it should be if you're truly a Renaissance person at least. Anyway, Castiglione wrote a book called The Courtier, and he inspired generations of people to study multiple subjects and become the ideal man or woman. Because he also encouraged women to be well-rounded in various subjects so that they could make a great catch for a guy. Yeah, wow. This sort of sounds like the impetus behind TV shows like The Bachelor or Bachelorette. I wonder how Castiglione might feel about those shows today. Anyway, besides the whole universal man or Renaissance man idea, let's talk a little bit about the changes in the art world. The art produced during that period that we now call the Renaissance is characterized by the use of a technique called perspective. This was very different from the artwork from the Middle Ages, in that medieval art seemed flat in appearance, very one-dimensional. Renaissance art is really characterized by depth. You can actually see various dimensions in paintings or see off into the distance. That's perspective, and you know, it marked a huge change in how objects, scenes, and people were portrayed. There was also an emphasis on realistic subjects, showing them in their ideal form. This really shows a change during the Renaissance period, and it's quite similar to the, you know, those statues that we saw from the Greco-Roman or classical eras. And you should be really familiar at this point with Leonardo da Vinci, who painted The Last Supper and the Mona Lisa. Other artists you want to familiarize yourself with include Michelangelo, who created the dome at St. Peter's, and the paintings on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel, as well as the statue of David. Michelangelo and da Vinci, like many Italian artists, they were really truly Renaissance men. And, they didn't simply paint. Other famous artists include Raphael, who is known for his realistic-looking portraits of the Virgin Mary, aka the Madonna. And there were also famous female painters during the Renaissance, including Anguissola and Gentileschi. Now, these are just a few of the many artists, and they lived sometimes hundreds of years apart. But the fact of the matter is, they often produced realistic subjects. They showed that perspective and depth in paintings. And many of these artists weren't just painters, they were true Renaissance men and women. All right, other notable changes during the Renaissance include the use of local languages or dialects called vernacular. We've studied that from the Middle Ages. Instead of simply writing in the official church language, which was Latin, artists and writers began producing works of art and literature in their native dialects. These writers influenced a literary movement that focused on the classics, realism, and something that we call human achievement. This whole movement was called, and hey, write this down, it's important, humanism. One writer in particular is considered to be the father of the humanist movement. His name was Petrarch. Again, look at your vocab list. Petrarch wrote in both Latin and Italian, and he wrote poetry, often sonnets, as well. Other humanist writers included Boccaccio, who wrote a very famous book called The Decameron. Perhaps one of the most famous writers from the Renaissance period was Niccolò Machiavelli, who was most well known perhaps for his advice that he dispensed to rulers of the city-states in his book called The Prince. In this book, Machiavelli said that in order to be successful, or be at least a successful politician in the Italian city-states, it was necessary to be ruthless and to be, quote, feared rather than loved, end quote. If you wanted to survive the political culture of the time, he argued, you had to be ruthless. And even today, many politicians have taken this advice. Okay, so we've learned that the Renaissance was, well, pretty much was born in Italy. And there were actually two different Renaissance periods. Yeah, two periods of change. In addition to the Italian Renaissance that began in the Italian city-states during the mid-1300s, another period of immense change began north of Italy during the 1400s, in places that we now refer to as England, Switzerland, France, Belgium, the Netherlands, as well as Germany. This period of time in Northern Europe during the 14 to 1500s is now referred to by the term Northern Renaissance. So write that down. Renaissance ideas spread through the Italian city-states via rich merchant families, whereas the Northern Renaissance had merchant families and powerful kings who were interested in new art and literature. We've already learned in lecture number one how both France and England became nations, each nation-state led by powerful kings. Eventually, both countries had legislative bodies that limited the king's power. England had parliament, while France had the Estates General. Well, in Northern Europe, Renaissance ideas from Italy will spread and combine with Northern traditions. Hello, cultural diffusion. Famous Northern Renaissance painters include Albrecht Dürer from Germany, look at your list, as well as Flemish painter from near what we now call Belgium and the Netherlands, named Jan van Eyck, look at your word list for the spelling. And another painter from the Northern Renaissance was a guy named Peter Bruegel, look at your list for spelling. Bruegel painted that peasant wedding painting that is on the cover of your packet. He showed real life in painting. And he wasn't in this particular painting, Peasant Wedding, he didn't just show the bride. Remember what I talked about in class? In fact, the feast and guests at the wedding seemed to be the center of attention, not just the bride. We care about this painting today because it really indicates how there was an increase in secular art and literature during the Renaissance. There wasn't only religious artwork. The literary movement that we now call humanism, which we've already learned was spawned in Italy, will also spread to Northern Europe. And here's the kicker. Humanism in Italy tended to be more secular or worldly, whereas humanism during the Northern Renaissance was actually more religious in nature, some argue. In fact, the type of humanism that emerged in Northern Europe was called Christian humanism. Christian humanists were obsessed with changing society, helping to educate people, and helping to inspire church reform. See, many people felt a major disconnect with the Catholic Church back then. Christian humanism was sort of an attempt to get people talking about the criticisms that people had about the church. These ideas will actually help to inspire a major overhaul of the Christian faith, which happens to be the topic of my next lecture. So more on that later. Some of the most well-known Christian humanists include a man named Desiderius Erasmus from the Netherlands, or from what we call Holland, as well as Thomas More from England. Erasmus wrote a book called In Praise of Folly, in which he made fun of people. You know, folly actually refers to foolishness. Thomas More attempted to depict an imaginary land in his book entitled Utopia, which is actually a word that means no place, because utopia can't really exist. And utopia is often depicted as a perfect place. Anyway, a famous female writer of the time, who was also considered a Christian humanist, was Christine de Pizan from France. So she was also considered a Christian humanist. All right, so the Northern Renaissance saw immense changes in Northern Europe brought about by the Italian Renaissance ideas. This was perhaps most apparent in England, where Renaissance ideas helped inspire what we now call the Elizabethan Age. The Elizabethan Age is a period of time in England that took place in the 1500s during the reign of Elizabeth I. She reigned from 1558 to 1603. Elizabeth I is generally considered to have been quite the progressive leader during her time. You know, she also had a kick-butt navy, and she defeated the seemingly invincible Spanish Armada. That's a complicated term for navy, yo. Anyway, this Spanish Armada belonging to King Philip II, he wanted to marry Elizabeth so he could control her, and she was like, whatever, not interested, bro, denied. And so he was like, I will use my navy to conquer your less powerful navy, woman, because I'm a guy and you're the weaker sex. And you know what? And then he lost to her much smaller navy, and he was like, oh, that's not cool. But more on that later. I digress. Anyway, Elizabeth was super interested in art and literature, not just kicking Spanish booty on the high seas. She was a huge patron of the arts. Some of the most well-known writers from the Elizabethan period include, hello, Shakespeare. Yes, and you should know who he is, if for nothing else, but to impress people using coy literary quotes and references in job interviews and amongst groups of people who will be constantly judging you as you grow older on your wit and general cultural knowledge. Yeah, it does get better, people, but there are still people who will judge you when you get older on your vocabulary and intellect. So Shakespeare is definitely a handy item in your toolkit for life, not to mention a great read, and nice for an evening of theater if you're so inclined. But again, I digress. All right, so we've been talking about the Northern Renaissance. How did these cool ideas spread? Well, by books, of course. But wait. How are these books made, you ask? Because I know that's what you're thinking. Well, in 1455, a German named Johann Gutenberg figured out how to mass produce books compared to how books had formerly been made, and hence had been super unavailable to the common man. Gutenberg's invention revolutionized how books were made. His invention, of course, was the printing press, which helped produce books quickly and cheaply. The first book produced, of course, was the Bible, which people began calling the Gutenberg Bible, and copies of which are evidently on display around the globe. Single pages from these are often auctioned off for like $100,000 a piece, and there is no known location for the original edition, okay? And by the way, the Koreans and Chinese had long been using movable type, so although we give Gutenberg lots of credit in the European arena, Asian cultures already had the technology. But of course, Gutenberg did a lot for Europe with his invention, and he helped to promote literacy. Overall, folks, we look at the time periods that we now refer to as both the Renaissance and Northern Renaissance periods as periods of much change. There were changes in artwork, literature, and society, and these collective changes will inspire a major overhaul of the church and its power over Western Europe. And that will be the topic of my next lecture. Thanks for listening.